Hello everyone, here we talk about hypothesis testing. Hypothesis testing is a statistical technique for testing a statement about population by using the data information of a sample. Usually, we would like to know the center value or average value about a population. However, we may not have all the information about the population, but we tend to make an assumption or statement about the population mean. We would like to know if the statement is acceptable. A random sample is taken from the population to test our statement. A decision will be made if we may accept or reject the statement based on the sample data result. Basically, there are two opposite assumptions. We call them hypotheses. The original assumption is called null hypothesis, and the opposite assumption is called alternative hypothesis. We use H0 to represent null hypothesis, and H1 is used to represent alternative hypothesis. The statement to be tested sets up the tone, how we are going to apply the sample result. Testing process will lead us to a conclusion. A decision will be made if we may accept or reject the statement based on the sample data result. We usually use a certain value as the null hypothesis for convenience. If we are testing a population mean, the null hypothesis would be written as the format like this: H0 mu equals to mu 0. Mu 0 is the certain value related to the statement being tested. For certain value mu 0, there are only three different format of statements. We may say the population mean is mu 0. We could also say the population mean is bigger than mu 0. Or we can make statement the population mean is smaller than mu 0. No matter which condition, we can always set up our null hypothesis as mu equals mu 0. When we have a statement, the population mean is mu 0. The opposite statement would be the population mean is not mu 0. When we state the population mean is bigger than mu 0, we potentially assume that population mean is not possible to be smaller than mu 0. Under this circumstance, the opposite statement is the population mean is mu 0. Similarly, when we state the population mean is smaller than mu 0, we potentially assume that population mean is not possible to be bigger than mu 0. Under this circumstance, the opposite statement is the population mean is mu 0. So there are three hypothesis models. Null hypothesis being written as mu is mu 0, and alternative hypothesis as mu is not mu 0. Or we have another model, say null hypothesis mu is mu 0, and the alternative one mu is bigger than mu 0. Or null hypothesis mu is mu 0, and the alternative one mu is smaller than mu 0. For the first case, we call the two-tailed hypothesis test. So when we have null hypothesis mu equals mu 0, so the opposite part including both sides could be smaller than, could be bigger than mu 0. That's why we call the two-tailed, or we call the two-sided, and it's also called the non-directional hypothesis test. For the other two, we only need to check one side, either on the right side or on the left side, because we already excluded the other side out. We do not consider that part situation be possible. So these two situations being called one-tailed or one-sided, and it is a directional hypothesis test. Here are some examples. If we are testing the statement in the manufacturer place, say boxing the cereal. So the box of cereal from a manufactured production line has a mean fill of 16 ounces. If we try to test this statement, or being a regular quality control, we try to find out if the production line is working properly. That's the statement we need to test. And we set up our null hypothesis is 16 ounces. That's the population mean. And alternative one, population mean is not 16 ounces. That's our testing model. It's two-sided or two-tailed hypothesis testing. The second example, if we are testing a research hypothesis, say Goodyear's tire will last longer than 60,000 miles on average. So we can see this tone. Directly, we do not consider the tire will last less than this number. We only say longer than this number. So in this case, our null hypothesis is still 60,000 miles. That's the population mean. And we're testing the population mean or Goodyear tire's life longer than 60,000 miles. This is a one-tailed hypothesis test. And another example, if we try to test a claim, say in a medical clinic, and we already have patients get there, may need some time to wait until the doctor ready. So here they have the claim saying mean waiting time or average waiting time in this medical clinic is less than 15 minutes. So potential tone saying they do not have that kind of observation more than 15 minutes. So that part being set it impossible. So we only need to check one side. So we set up our null hypothesis. Mu is 15 minutes. And the alternative hypothesis, mu, is less than 15 minutes. This is also one-tailed or one-sided hypothesis test. The process of hypothesis testing is theoretically based on sampling distribution. For testing population mean, the following sampling distributions are the foundation. We have learned this before. If we assume the population mean, mu 0, and the population standard deviation sigma is known, then the sample mean, x bar, follows normal distribution with mean mu 0 and standard deviation sigma over square root n. Here n is the size of the sample. That means how many data in that sample. Or we can say the standardized sample mean follows standard normal distribution. We use x bar minus the center value mu 0 and then divide by the standard deviation of this sampling distribution, and it follows normal standard distribution. Here x bar, the sampling mean, is random variable. We clearly know there's a lot of random samples that could be taken. one sample has the one sample mean, another sample has another sample mean. That's why the sample mean is a random variable. Another sampling distribution we learned, if we still talk about the population with mean mu zero, but this time we do not know the population standard deviation sigma. So sigma is unknown. We do not have this information. In this case, and we can still standardize the sample mean by using sample standard deviation. So that means x bar minus mu zero divided by, here you can see S represents sample standard deviation. We can always get sample standard deviation since we have the data of the sample. So sample standard deviation divided by square root n, which is sample size, and we have the knowledge, say this random variable follows the t distribution, or called the student distribution. This distribution, we have the degree of freedom, which is sample size minus 1. Here's the logic about hypothesis testing. According to the sampling distribution, if the null hypothesis mu is a 0 is true, the mean of a random sample should have quite high probability to be around mu 0. That's what we say center area or center interval. But the sample mean has small chance to be far from mu 0. We should have this kind of basic understanding by now. So when we are testing the statement mu equals mu 0 from a random sample mean x bar, we pick up a random sample, we have the random sample mean x bar. If the sample mean x bar is near mu 0, we can hardly reject the null hypothesis. Population mean is mu 0. If the sample mean x bar is far from mu 0, we may have a chance to reject the null hypothesis. We do have a question. Say, is this population mean is mu 0? The question come out because the sample mean is far from mu 0. The truth is, there are always small percent of the sample means fall out of the center interval of mu 0. Even if the null hypothesis mu 0 is true, even we know the population mean is mu 0, we still have small percent of the sample means they could fall out of this center area. So if we happen to pick up this kind of random sample, and we come out question that population mean, and we may reject the null hypothesis, say population mean is not mu 0, because the sample mean is far from mu 0. In this case, we could have made a mistake by rejecting a true statement. This kind of mistake of rejecting a true null hypothesis is called a type 1 error. And another question is, when we try to make decision to reject or not reject the null hypothesis, we wonder how far that sample mean x bar is from the mu 0 should be considered as far enough to reject the null hypothesis. Let's find out. Really, we cannot avoid making mistakes. We would like to set up a tolerance level for making mistakes, a standard of how much chance to be allowed to make type 1 mistake should be set. We use alpha to represent the maximum probability being allowed to make type 1 error. Alpha is called significance level. With this significance level, the cutoff value or the border for the center interval would be identified based on the sampling distribution. The cutoff value would give us a clear idea how far the sample mean from the center, mu 0, should be considered far enough to reject the null hypothesis. Even if the rejection is a mistake, we clearly know that maximum probability of making this mistake is alpha. Here's the chart. It shows you clearly. So we set up the border being identified by significance level, so which is out of the center area, so that the two green areas together is alpha. Since the distribution, either normal distribution or T distribution, they are symmetrical, so each side of the little tail would be half alpha, and inside the center part would be 1 minus alpha. So with this probability, half alpha on each side of the little tail, the green area, and we can find out the value on axis, that being marked as the standard value, or if we use original, would it be called the cutoff value? So here standard value is z alpha over 2, or we say z half alpha. And symmetrically, the other side is negative z half alpha. We just try to mark it to make sure we recognize this standard value related to the area half alpha. And this standard value give us the idea how far should be considered as far enough to reject null hypothesis. 1 minus alpha is also called confidence level. And for this standard value, z half alpha is also called critical value. Here we have an example. A company that packages oatmeal uses an automatic fueling machine that is set so that the mean fuel volume is 16 ounces. The machine has a known standard deviation, which is 0.422 ounces. With the fuel distribution that is normally distributed, to determine if the machine is still fueling with the mean equal to 16 ounces, a random sample of 49 boxes of cereal was selected. The sample mean turned out to be 16.2 ounces. So based on this information, we would like you to conduct the hypothesis test to see if this production line, the machine, is working fine. So here we do give you the significance level, or we say tolerance level, 10%. So that means you are allowed 10% of chance to make type 1 mistake. Based on the information, we have already explained that the model should be two-tailed or two-sided hypothesis test. Our null hypothesis, population mean is 16 ounces. Alternative hypothesis, population mean is not 16 ounces. And here we can show the chart, normal distribution, and the sampling distribution is also normal distribution. And we can show you original one, mu 0, 16. So when we make standardize, it towards to 0. So here we show you the standard normal distribution chart. And the two side, the little tail, green part, each part would be 5%. Since we have significance level 0.1, so half alpha would be 0.05. Test statistic is actually calculating standardized sample mean value. Here's our standardized sample mean value after the calculation with all the information provided in the question, we turn out the standard value 3.32. And we are going to compare this 3.32, see if this is far enough from the center. What we compare to the critical value right now showing at the bottom, which is both sides 1.645 and negative 1.645. That's our critical value. This critical value comes from the area, green area being set 5%. So we clearly know this critical value. How do you find out? You can easily get it from Excel function. So you use a standard normal distribution based on the probability and find out the critical value. And the both sides symmetrical, they only have the difference as negative sign. But when you apply Excel function, make sure you understand Excel function take the information which is cumulative probability. So that means on the right side, the critical value, it comes from all the way left side of that critical value, how much percentage that area is. And we know each side 5%, so center part is 90%. So in that case, on the right side of the critical value, if you count all the probability on the left side would be 95%. So the area is 0.95. So you put 0.95. That's your only information need to put in. And the other one will be simple because your little tail left side that's 5%. So you directly put the information 0.05. So now we can make a decision. So our test statistic give us the value 3.32 and our critical value 1.645. So 3.32 is bigger than 1.645, being considered as far enough to reject null hypothesis. So we make a conclusion, we reject H0 null hypothesis. This kind of approach is called a compare the statistic and the critical value. So we calculate the sample statistic or testing statistic, and then we compare to the critical value based on significance level. We do have different approach with the same background. So we have both sides required significance level. And here, if we look at our original information, so all the sampling mean supposed to have center 16. That's our assumption based on this, because population mean assumed 16. So we want to know what is the real cutoff value. If we find the real cutoff value, we can directly use the sample mean 6.2 compared to the cutoff value and see if it's far enough. So that means the two border should be figured out. And here is how. So we calculate mu 0 plus minus, so that is the both end of the center interval based on the standard value, critical value. And we can calculate the cutoff value. 16 plus minus 0.09917. So we mark this, that's what we got. So the right side 16.1, the left side 15.9. And then we can make decision based on this result. Since 16.2 is greater than 16.1, that being considered far enough from the center, so we reject null hypothesis. So this is different approach. We could compare the sample mean and cutoff value directly. We do have another popular approach. We continue from our first method. We calculate the test statistic, or we call the standardized sample mean value, which is 3.32. Earlier we have finished this calculation. So we mark on the chart, this is a standard normal distribution chart, center is 0. We mark both of them, negative 3.32, positive 3.32. And then based on this test statistic, we calculate how much chance we randomly pick up a sample, and this sample mean would fall in these two areas, the green area. How much chance? So this chance would be considered, since these two areas are same, so we can use 2 times one of them. So we use the right side, so that means how much chance the random variable z standard value is bigger than 3.32. This is what we call the p-value. We finish this calculation, we get a p-value, which is 0.001. This probability can be found out from Excel in a very convenient way. Here it shows. Again, Excel function give you the left side area, cumulative probability. So when we look at the right side, the little tail, the green area, so we have to use 1. 1 means 100%. 1 minus from 3.32 cutoff, this part, all the left, and they give us the answer. We put this number above and give us 2 times this, give us the p-value. P-value including both sides. So this is what we are doing, two-sided hypothesis testing. Then we can make a decision based on this p-value, compare to significance level. Our significance level is 0.1. So compare the p-value 0.01, much smaller than significance level, then we make decision to reject null hypothesis. This approach we call the p-value approach. So the p-value approach is comparing p-value to significance level. The idea is p-value give you the probability, how much chance this kind of situation would happen. And it turned out this chance very small. But if you random pick up sample and this sample turned out give you this kind of result, so you have enough evidence to question this original assumption should not be true. And we do have a general reference, even sometimes if we don't have preset significance level, we can just make some judgment based on the p-value. So here is the general reference about the p-value. How we decide to reject null hypothesis, or we tend to think alternative hypothesis is true based on the p-value. Here is the general reference. If p-value is less than 1%, we see we have overwhelming evidence, highly significant, to reject H0. If we have p-values between 1% to 5%, we call this evidence as strong or significant. If we have p-values bigger than 5%, less than 10%, we call this evidence as weak evidence. Not quite satisfied, we may not quite comfortable to reject H0. If the p-value is greater than 10%, we would say very little evidence. Normally, we do not reject null hypothesis in this case. See you next time.